chapter long?
It's not too bad. All right, question number three. Name a factor that influences exercise participation levels for adults. Name a factor that influences exercise participation levels for adults.
Can you say that one more time?
Name a factor that influences.
Name a factor that influences exercise participation levels for adults.
I was gonna ask that too, but I thought you, I knew you were gonna ask that.
Where is he? Nathan O. Hudson. All right, so name on there. Swap off.
All right, so I have.
All right. Ready? Okay, question number one. Self-esteem becomes more accurate as we get older. So 1 point for more. The reasons people give for their success or failure at a task are called causal attributions. Causal attributions. So 1 point for causal attributions. And then name a factor that influences exercise participation levels for adults. So there's loads of those. It could be a sense of self, it could be perceived options, childhood experiences,
fun.
Lack of role models.
Fun?
I would give a half for
age.
Fun for adults.
Age.
Age.
I'll give you a half.
Half the age.
What about other adults participating?
Personal incentives.
But their physical state.
See, fun would go under personal incentives, I think.
What about other adults participating?
That would be role models, so yes.
Yes,
right. Lack of opportunity. Okay, so it's quite a lot of flexibility on that last one. Alright, so we're going to try a little activity to get you in the right frame of mind for this chapter. Alright, so probably stand up would be easier. Alright, and you're going to try and juggle the scarves. So Dr. Berkey tells me that you should have two scarves in one hand and one scarf in the other hand. And try juggling the scarf. Don't be guard.
Just another day in the office.
Come on, Emma.
All right.
Hey, watch it. This is
You see it, Emma?
I did really good.
Is that in your vocabulary?
What? That's your point.
There should be one in the air.
Did you do it? I missed it.
Wake up.
Okay. So, think about how you felt about that. If you thought you did a really good job, go over to this side of the room. If you think you were struggling and you felt like not very good at it,
I got you.
Go over to this side of the room.
Say no.
Hey, shut your
ass. I'll say no.
Y'all lying, huh? This can be good.
Are you sure you want to decorate to engage in. And that then indirectly affects what movements we see emerge, right? What skills do we see develop? So the environment interacting with that, how I feel about something, is an important aspect, we think. Right? How do I perceive myself? How do I feel when someone presents me with a task to try, particularly if it's in front of other people? So we use the term self-esteem. In this book, they define self-esteem as someone's self-evaluation of their capability. I'll give you a slightly different model in a minute to look at. But self-esteem isn't just a global concept. I don't just have self-esteem about myself. I don't have self-confidence, in their words. I don't think I'm good or bad. What we find, we have a global idea. On the whole, I think I'm a good person, right? Do I do bad things occasionally? Yes. But I don't think I'm a bad person or that I'm not capable. But when we look at specific areas, right? So what we find is that we develop self-esteem in relation to very specific areas. So we have self-esteem about our physical appearance, right? Some people are very confident about how they look when they go to a party. Other people are less confident, right? Some people will just chuck on a pair of jeans and a t-shirt, and other people are going to spend hours in the bathroom making sure that everything looks right because they're a little less confident about walking into the room. Okay? We have self-esteem about school, okay? And then we have self-esteem that we're interested in about physical ability. Am I good or poor at moving? We find that this self-esteem, though, isn't just about that domain, right? So, am I good at school? Relatively. What about, are you good at astrophysics?
Well, maybe PE.
Right. So, are you good at PE?
Yes.
Yes. Right? So even when we look at self-esteem to do with academia, we can break it down further to self-esteem related to particular topics. And we see the same thing with physical activity and moving. I can be very confident on a trampoline, right? I wish we had a trampoline here. I used to nag Dr. Drabs wicked to get us a trampoline, but she wouldn't do it, right? I'm very confident on a trampoline. I'm very not confident on a basketball court, so I wouldn't go near or nigh a basketball game. So what are you very confident at then? In the weight room. What movement skill would you go, oh, no way, don't make me do that? Would you try a cartwheel?
You
can do a cartwheel? So that would be okay. What about...
I'd say a backflip.
A backflip? Okay. Right? So if you think about how you feel individually about different types of movements, how you feel kind of drives what you choose to do. Right? How many of you would take a ballet class? Right? How many of you would take the weight class as your activity on your degree plan? Right? All of you. Right? So how I think, right? Do you take the weight class thinking you're going to be really bad at it, or do you think you're going to be okay and you're going to get stronger? So you think you're going to be able to lift the weights and look okay, right? So it plays a role. What is interesting is that the belief in the self-evaluation, so if I think I'm right about how I feel, that is more important than whether or not I'm actually right. Okay? So if someone else tells you you're really, really good at catching a ball, and you think, and they can measure it, and they can go, look, you caught it 8 out of 10 times, but you think you're bad, your self-esteem will be low, even though they tell you over and over again that you're not bad, right? That changes a little bit as we get older, as we'll see. It's worse for children than it is for adults. But the belief in it is more important than the actual accuracy, whether or not your self-evaluation is correct. Okay. So it's important because that's motivating or demotivating, right? If I don't think I'm very good, it's demotivating. So people with low self-esteem in physical activity tend to use avoidance tactics to not do physical activity. People who have very high self-esteem for physical activity will do anything they can to be as physically active as possible. So understanding how this concept works becomes important if we want to be able to motivate. Our job is going to be motivating other people to move, right? Whether I'm a PE teacher, whether I'm a coach, whether I'm a personal trainer, whether I'm a parent, given the literature on sedentary behavior in children, right? Your job when you leave here is going to be motivating people to move. So how does self-esteem play a role in that? So I want to give you another idea to think about that they don't use in the book, but it's quite an interesting model. It's a hierarchical model of self-concept and perceived competence. And we're going to come back to the idea of perceived competence in a couple of weeks. All right? And this model was developed by a lady called Susan Harter. The book does have some of her work. She's done a lot of work did a lot of work with children and adults and youth on self-esteem and the development of self-esteem. So in her model, the first step is self-concept. Right? And in this model, self-concept is defined as a value-free understanding of us as a person. So have you ever thought, you know, when your dog or your cat will come to a mirror, do they know that's them in the mirror? Right? We do, right? I'm not sure that they do, right? But when you look in a mirror, once you're past the age of about 14 months, you know that that's you, right? I know who that is. That's me. Yes.
When I went to Africa like 3 years ago, and like it was a group of kids, and like they really couldn't pick themselves out either because they don't have drinks.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
What is
they the probably have a different. I would suspect that their self-concept is about them. Within their family, maybe, rather than actually recognizing their physical. I don't know enough about the literature. That's interesting. That's cool. I'll try to look that up. Or you look it up. Come and tell us about it. Even better idea, Jeremy. All right. So self-concept is value-free, right? And self-concept leads to self-esteem in this model. So if I have a positive concept of myself, I recognize myself, I kind of know where I fit in the family. Positive self-concept tends to generate more positive self-esteem. Right? Self-esteem, though, is not value-free. Self-esteem, self-worth, is my judgment of who I am as a person. Am I worthy? Right? Am I a worthy person? What value do I place on my capability? And as I say, it's a slightly different perspective to the one in the book, but it's always interesting to look at someone else's approach, right? Self-esteem leads to self-confidence. So the higher my evaluation of myself, the more confidence I have in myself. I believe I can carry out a task. I trust myself to do the task. So in our case, a movement calm. I'm self-confident about doing a handstand.
Show me.
Show you?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
If you ask me to hit a golf shot, that would make me nervous because I would go swing and a miss, right? So self-esteem leads to self-confidence. If I'm self-confident, then I'm likely to try things and have a go at things, which leads to competence. Not anymore. But quite often. If I'm confident enough to do the task, then I develop competence because I do the task enough times that I become good at it. I become skilled. Competence is how skillful am I at the task. And the more competent I am, the more perceived competence I develop. And perceived competence is my feeling about my opportunity for success if I try the skill again. Right? So this is going to play a big role in the model we're going to look at towards the end of the semester. Perceived competence. Do I believe I can be successful at moving? Or at a particular given moving task. Okay? So, back to this.
Miss, what is it? The Harder model? Or?
Yeah, this is Susan Harter. And they do have some information on her work in the book, they just don't use this particular model. And I think it's quite an interesting one to think about, particularly since we're going to come back to these two constructs later in the semester. All right, development of self-esteem. So by now you should know that we're going to talk about the fact that there's a developmental trend for basically everything, right? Whatever we look at. So when we're looking at the development of self-esteem, what do we see with different age groups, with different individuals? So children under the age of 10 are not very accurate. Children, period, are not very accurate, but under the age of 10, they're really pretty bad at judging their physical competence. Right? The children on the playground have no clue, okay? Which is good for us because they all think they're really good at moving, which motivates them to move more. So that's actually very beneficial. It's much harder to work with adults because they've already decided they can't do something.
Oh,
right?
No, the like a perfect example is because I helped train with LV, like some of the girl athletes, when it comes to like snatch and overhead movement, they want nothing to do with it. And they're really, some of them are really strong, but it's just like they're not confident enough to throw shit up.
And what is a snatch a typical girl lift?
Yeah, but they're more better at it.
They're better at it because we're more flexible. Do you think there's a gender thing in there? Do you think it's all...
It depends on the sport itself. Right. It depends on the sport, but it is a lot of... Like, even male athletes, a lot of them, if you ask them, hey, you're strong enough to clean 300 pounds, they're like, they'll lift it up and be like, no, I can't do it. Because they just don't have confidence.
What about anybody when we had the climbing rope out? Did anybody work with Hirati?
Hirati.
I'm doing that.
Yeah, we
did.
Yeah.
Oh, the
cargo net? The cargo net. Right?
That's our.
Some of the children look at the cargo net and won't even by the time they're four or five, they'll look at the cargo net and go, no, I'm not going to try that and look away. Right? So even by five, they're starting to decide that they can't do something. But on the whole, we're pretty lucky with that age group. It's easy to get them going. Right? So under 10, they do make comparisons with their peers. So they'll compare themselves to another child on the playground. But it really doesn't depend as much on that as it does on the parents and the outcome, right? The comparison with the peers doesn't play as big a role as what their parents tell them and the outcome of the skill, whether or not they're successful at the skill. As we move into older than 10, then they start to rely on and use that information from their peer group a lot more. So they'll watch each other in your PE room. And they'll make a decision whether or not they're going to join in based on how good they think they are compared to everybody else. Right? And that tends to develop into teenagers. So, children of all ages, though, develop self-esteem from feedback. So the more positive I am with them, the more self-esteem they'll develop about something. I want to be very positive when I'm giving feedback on movement skills. We want high perceptions of competence. What feedback am I going to give them? How am I going to give them? Am I going to tell them, no, that was wrong, do it this way?
No.
Right? Shouldn't do that. Right? The first thing out of your mouth has to be something positive. So somehow, when you're watching these skills, you've got to find something that was good, say that first, and then give them feedback about what they did wrong. Don't tell them straight away what they did wrong. That's very...
Sandwich.
Yes.
Sandwich.
Right? So coaches who work with teenage boys or young boys who are very positive have a really good impact on helping those boys transition from low self-esteem for moving to high self-esteem. The data with the girls is a little bit more iffy, but with the boys, it's very strong. A coach who is very positive, who gives lots of positive feedback, can change a male from low to high self-esteem. Global praise doesn't seem to work well at all with children, so you can't tell the whole team, you guys did a really great job. Right? That doesn't work. You have to do individual if you want to impact an individual self-esteem. Just telling the whole team they did a good job doesn't work on the individual who thinks that they did poorly or that they're not any good at it. Right? So if I want to change that particular person, I have to do one-on-one. Oh, with the emotion. There we go. All right. All right, so emotions, right? We just had a little activity and we were thinking about emotions. So emotions associated with participation in physical activity or sport or exercise affect the development of my self-esteem. So if I have success at the activity, then what do I feel about myself? You feel confident? Have some pride in the job that I did, right? So if you guys play a great game, at the end of the game, you're proud of that work that you did out there on the field, right? If you play a bad game, not so much fun, right? So if I'm successful, I feel proud of the job, that develops self-confidence. I'm excited to have another go at it, right? If I fail at the job, what do I feel? Yeah, I feel like going back out there, right? I'm disappointed, probably in myself, particularly if I thought I could at least give it a decent shot. Right? So I might be disappointed. It might be stressful to think about having another go. So these all influence my self-esteem and my motivation to continue. So we're back at the beginning of the semester. We talked about the idea that when we set up an activity, we have to have lots of levels of challenge so that everybody has the opportunity to be successful. Right? And I don't, as the teacher, define success by one outcome, because then only a few people in the class are gonna achieve the outcome and everybody else fails, right? And that's a problem because when we fail, we don't wanna come back and give it again. So as a teacher, we're trying to develop this self-esteem, this competence at skills. Enjoyment becomes really, really important. Enjoyment leads to higher self-esteem, right? Because I enjoy it when I'm successful.
Like all this stuff doesn't characterize some of the coaches.
It should. It should. I know it doesn't. I'm sorry about that. And that could be. My personal philosophy is different to that. I think it's always for fun. Yeah. And then it's also for business, because if I'm having fun, then I have to be being successful. And if I'm being successful, that would be beneficial for the business. So
how fun can something be if you're always kind of worried about it and keep yourself short? That's why it's not.
It's difficult for the coaches because their job relies on it, right?
And what's the point of playing if not having fun?
Yes, like,
why are you not
I agree. Then quit.
Yeah, exactly.
That's how I feel, but that's my personal philosophy, right? If it's not fun, why do it? No, I think if you're
like sometimes you only have this is some people's only. There's no other chance to go to college. This is their only chance. And it was all fun in high school until you got to college, because then you realize it's not the
same. Yeah,
you can try to say this for as much as you want, but this is... Like, for some, sure, it's
well,
a lot of fun, especially when you're Johnny and Will.
I would argue, though, I would argue that coming to school is fun. Right. So if your scholarship gives you the opportunity to play football and be in school and create a better future for yourself? Is that not a form of success and therefore fun?
There's no fun about it, though.
There's no fun about that?
There's no break, there's no time to have fun. You know what I'm saying? There's no fun.
The doing is the fun. It's a different mindset. I would not want to be there. The doing is the fun. For me. Okay? If my goal is the degree and I am being successful moving towards that goal, then that would be enjoyable for me.
When you write down 100-page paper, that's what I want to do.
But it gets you closer to your goal.
Would you rather write a 100-page paper or work a 9-to-5 job? Which one's fun?
There you go.
Would now my job make it 7:50 an hour? Like, I don't want to do that in my life.
Right?
Also,
Yes, but your mindset makes you depressed because you don't want to write a 100-page paper, right? Instead of looking at a 100-page paper as another positive step towards the goal. Right? Anyway, we have to get back to this. So, enjoyment is furthered by perceptions of high ability. So that feedback, if we use mastery climate, right? The climate on the playground is a mastery climate. The idea behind that climate is to allow the children to connect how hard they're working with a positive outcome, right? If I put forth effort, I will achieve mastery. That's the goal of that kind of climate. People use it in all different areas of sport and PE. We want as much of the pressure from the parents off as possible, right? Some parents are very, very good at putting their kids in the sport they want them to be successful at rather than what the child wants to be doing. And then telling them they have to win every time they walk out on the field. That's right. I lost a lot of gymnasts because their parents told them that they can't fall off the beam, and when they fall off the beam, they yell at them. Okay. So, how do I develop greater parent, greater athlete, greater coach satisfaction? Right? The more satisfied the parents are, the better the goal set of the parent, right? Which you have to kind of manipulate when you're coaching. Right? What goals are you going to have the parents set? Can you make those more realistic so that the kids can have more fun?
My mom did.
So, our idea of causal attributions then. Causal attributions is the term that we use for the reasons that people give for the success or failure that they have at a task. All right, so who gets the credit? What gets the credit? And what we see is that depending upon whether they have high self-esteem at the task or low self-esteem, they give different causal attributions. And people then tend to act in a way that will support what they believed in the first place. So for example, if I think I'm really bad at math, I don't work very hard at my maths homework. And I don't study very hard at maths because I'm not very good at maths. And then when I take the exam, guess what? I fail the exam. And then that just reminds me that I'm not very good at maths. So typically, we act out what we thought was going to happen in the first place, right? Not deliberately, it's just that the actions we choose end up supporting what we originally believed. So if I have low perceived competence and low self-esteem, if I put those two things together, so I don't believe I'm capable and I don't trust that I can be successful at this skill, you're not going to be. What we get is low performance. Right? So if I'm coaching, it's really important that I have players with high self-esteem. And you can tell whether they have low or high self-esteem by these causal attributions. What are they saying about why we won or why we lost? Or why they missed the ball? So a person with high self-esteem tends to say things that involve the following. They use terminology and words that suggest that they're responsible, it was what they did. So they're internal, right? The causal attribution is internal. What they did influenced the outcome. So I worked really hard, and therefore I'm not 2 seconds off my personal best. The causal attributions also tend to be stable. So that's the factors that influence the outcomes tend to be consistent from one situation to the next. Right? So it's stable. If it happened this time, it can happen again. And it's controllable. I'm in charge. Okay? Not you. I'm in charge of what happens, not anybody else, right? So my success could be due to my physical ability and my hard work. That's internal, right? It's, I can win again the next time I run this race. I just won, I can win again. I'm not gonna come out and lose, right? That's stable. And it was nothing to do with luck, I did it. I worked hard, I'm in control. Right? This one's quite interesting because that comes back to this motivation idea. Right? If I have high self-esteem and I lose, what do I have to do to win?
Work harder.
Work harder. Right? So it's controllable. If I want to win the next time, I'm in control of that. I work harder. Right? We'll see a slightly different picture. If we have low self-esteem, then we get different language. So if I have low self-esteem, we say that winning or losing was nothing to do with me. Right? It was the coach's fault. They didn't train me hard enough. Or it was because the wind was blowing in my face. Or, right, something external to them. And it's unstable. So just because I won this time doesn't mean I can win again. Right? This outcome has no reflection on what is going to come down the line. And it's uncontrollable. I can't control any of this. It's nothing to do with me. It doesn't make any difference how hard I work. I'm not in control of what is going to happen.
Isn't that like people, like it's in God's hands?
Sorry?
It's in God's hands? Like it's controllable?
Yes, I think so. Yes. All right, so they're going to say that they fail because of the coach or because they just are not good enough, right? If they win, it's because they were lucky, not because of anything they did. So it's not controllable because it was luck. Okay? They can't repeat it, so it's unstable. They can't repeat the performance. Okay? Okay, so Monday we'll look at